I best get that article up here.
Well, yeah, I'm sending you another article too. Oh, cool. Gmail just crashed.
Nice.
As I was emailing it to you.
Sick.
What the fuck? Every time I try to paste it, it crashes. Weird. It must be ChatGPT or like.
Oh, yeah.
Like, they don't want us to talk about.
Maybe. Maybe that's
dude,
it.
Dude, you never know. Like, what the fuck?
The powers that be.
Yeah. I can text it to you. I don't know. Maybe that'll do something. Because there's a. You know what, chat? Oh, man. Hearing all these names. Otis.
Oh,
Jimmy. Janice. You know what? I don't care how good of a fucking robot or whatever you are. You're never going to be as good as Janice and Otis.
Damn, I'm not even recording. Elvis. I'm not even recording the song, you know? It's going to go. I'm going to have to splice it in. So embarrassing. So embarrassing. But like now, though, because I'm a professional,
yeah.
I've figured it out.
Nice.
So I'll have to splice that in, but I know where it, like, it, where it was kind of.
I think you sound great, man.
Yeah, you like this?
Yeah, and I'm gonna, you know what, I'm gonna just kind of, from now on, now you've inspired me. I'm getting the stand today, and then I'm gonna have my mic off a bit, tiny bit more
so,
ambience.
Well, I'm using a different microphone, so
you got a condenser, right?
I'm using a Neumann microphone.
You had to drop that, didn't you?
Well, it's the one that people don't like, though. It's the TLM-103.
Right.
A lot of people don't like it. It's sort of meant to be the U87 capsule, but people say it sounds like shit. It doesn't actually, I actually don't like it either. I bought it. It was one of the first ones.
People like to hate on Neumanns.
No, I think this one specifically.
Well, yeah, I know, but I know some people who will go nameless.
No, no.
Who've they don't even like it, like an 87. Or
well, actually, I'll tell you, I was in the studio yesterday with an artist, a female artist who's got an amazing voice, but, you know, more like rocking, like, but she can do anything, man. Like, she's got, like, called Alex Little. I made a record of hers a few years ago with her band, and she's such a good songwriter and an amazing vocalist, and kind of, like, just her musical knowledge is so vast that she can kind of almost, like, she never, like, leans into doing it, but she can kind of do every voice. All the voices, and like can turn the grit on or soften it up. But she's such an amazing singer, great songwriter. And we had a song yesterday that was like dangerously kind of creeping into sort of like spooky ballad territory.
Spooky ballad.
Well, not
what?
The song spooky, but a bit the song spooky actually.
Yeah, that's what I thought you meant when you said that.
Yeah, which is one of your karaoke classics.
What is a spooky ballad?
Well, it was just kind of like it became ballady, the song, based on the way the song was kind of being created in the studio. But the choruses we made really surfy and kind of intense.
It's like minor chord ballad. It's kind
just
of
soft. It was just soft, and the lyrical,
I see.
The lyrical output was quite like redemptive but soft. And so I was doing the vocal on an 87. And it just sounded too, it like kind of fit the song too well. You know, it was this like open sounding voice, vocal performance. So she sung it a few times and I was like, can we try you on an RE20? You know?
There you go.
It's just a harder mic. It's more forgiving. It's like, if you want to sound like, you know, Celine Dion.
Stevie Wonder, Paul McCartney.
Oh, no, I know. Tom York.
Yeah.
And I believe, Johnny, you...
Exactly. Sorry, I forgot about the third of the three grades.
I believe you just bought one, didn't you, Johnny?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I recently got one. And I my old studio...
Nice.
...space...
Huh? Nothing, I'm just being a dickhead.
At my old studio space were in Vancouver, where you've been there and we used to record a little bit.
It's amazing space.
A guy there had an RE20 and he used to let me use it whenever I wanted to. And it was my preferred kick drum mic.
Oh, definitely.
And I sang a lot into it too.
Yeah, so, it's great. Yeah. They're great. So she sounded fantastic on it. It sorted it all out. Hardness and softness scales with microphones, right? Like if something sounds soft, like she can sing really hard, but because she was singing soft on a UH7, that's a soft microphone. it didn't work.
Yeah, and if it's a kind of a rock performance too, yeah. you know, you might not, a tender mic like that might not be the right choice.
Well, or just like making it slightly, I don't like to use the word because it's not what it does, but like more lo-fi, maybe more kind of
definitely
indie, more
punk.
Alt.
Yeah.
Punk. But, bit you know, punk. Then the Beatles used like a lot of real nice Neumann mics, so.
Well, you know, some people say they're the first punks.
Well,
not
yeah,
many
they,
people,
but that doesn't make sense because they were using Neumann mics. And
oh, right.
Based
oh,
on
I thought you meant Paul using the RE20.
In the 70s.
Yeah, yeah. Which is kind of...
I'm sure he used everything. It's one photo of him using an RE20. Like one time. And now everyone... Because no one can afford the mics they used.
Yeah.
So I wonder if Giles, like...
Everybody says that the SM7 is yeah. Michael Jackson
yeah.
and the
well,
RE20 is Paul McCartney.
They used it once.
I know, but because they're affordable.
Yeah,
and everybody's like, well, because it's easy if you're recording somebody to be like, maybe I'll just throw you up on like the Michael Jackson. And they're like, whoa,
yeah.
really?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's exactly it.
And you're like, yeah, because I can't actually afford like the
well,
crazy...
Anything.
Condenser that like everyone... you like Sam, you know, Sam, bless his heart. He sent me, because he and I are going to do some more recording this year.
Brilliant.
And he sent me, he's really into Rosalia.
She's great. She's amazing. Yeah. Her music's amazing.
And, yeah, and I've been listening to it a lot. And he's like, I wonder what kind of mic she sings into, you know?
Right.
And I was like, what? He's like, because, you know, if we could get one of those, that'd be just be cool to use whatever mic she uses, you know? So he found a picture, a photograph of her using an SM7. And I was like, oh, sick. We can definitely use that, you know.
Yeah.
And then he found this other picture of this black condenser mic and like of her singing into it a lot in the studio. And he's like, what's this one? And I was like, I don't really know. And then I sort of zoomed in and looked at it. And it was a Sony.
Oh, those ones are really, really expensive. They're like,
yeah.
And then I
looked it up. $11,500. Yeah.
That's the pop mic. Yeah. That's kind of like those manly mics, those manly gold reference mics that I don't know.
There's a manly at 604, isn't there?
There's two there. They're really expensive, kind of like that era, that sort of like price point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But so it's just kind of funny. It's like, yeah, well, SM7, you know, we can, I think that'd be better for you. You know,
yeah, I mean, I think that like I've got to say, I don't like this, how this sounds to me in my ears. I've done so many podcasts with the SM7. I'm freaking out a bit.
Just turn up your cans.
No, Mike, it's fine. It's just there's too much ambience.
Oh, the ambience.
yeah, it's freaking
me out.
Well,
you're going to have your work cut out for you in the mixing room. Afterwards.
Oh, I don't give a shit what people hear. I'm talking about my performance.
Oh, you sound good to me. I like it.
Yeah. Well, it's nice to be completely free.
Yeah, I feel like we're more like in a coffee shop.
Hey, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I wanted to say, though, just because you
nice.
Said something that was interesting to me and had a funny eyewall thing when you were talking about a spooky ballad.
Yeah.
I don't know why I'm linked on this. I was thinking, like, what are some spooky ballads? Because I was thinking, if there's a ballad
Total
with
Eclipse of the Heart.
Yes, good one. And, like, what's a minor key ballad? And I was thinking Pink Floyd have quite a few. Like comfortably
yesterday.
Numb.
Yesterday is.
Yeah, that's more forlorn to me than
Pretty
spooky.
Ballerina.
Yeah, a bit. Yeah, a bit.
Anything
more,
by the Zombies.
That's more Baroque. But I like.
Okay,
yeah,
so
I
not
guess,
Baroque. You just mean haunted.
Not Baroque. I mean like.
Haunted
I mean like
music.
Haunting ballads.
Bit like
because
like
obviously
Smith
hate.
Did one.
Yeah, probably, yeah. Or, like, is, like, November Rain kind of
yeah,
spooky?
Yeah, I think a bit, well, I mean, it's demented.
It's more forlorn, like, not forlorn, like, more, like, pensive.
Spooky about Time After Time?
Kind of, yeah.
But, like, redemptive
bit.
As well.
That's redemptive, too. Hopeful.
Hopeful, yeah.
That's not what I'm going for.
What
I'm
about Luca?
More like Comfortably Numb
abuse.
Is the perfect one. Like, relax.
Oh, yeah,
it's just a little pinprick. You know what I mean? It's
oh, like Twisted.
Yeah, haunting. A little
the
scary.
The Time Warp. A bit like The Time Warp or something.
Not really a ballad, though. That's
no.
like, yeah. Alice Cooper's probably got a couple.
Oh, you know who does? Like, Changes by Ozzy Osbourne.
Yeah, that is.
Maybe. Just
because
he's spooky.
Just because he's spooky.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Probably some Led Zeppelin.
No, not really. It's more kind of fantastical or medieval sure. in spirit.
Well, listen, yeah, I don't know. Get anyway, back to us on the Discord if you can think of any spooky ballads you're listening to. Impossible Way of Life. I want to get this in under 10 minutes because it's the good way to do it. To tell people, because it's a free episode.
Oh, right. Yeah.
That this is a bi-weekly rock and roll podcast, mostly Beatles.
Yeah.
Sometimes we're switching up our like audio engineering kind of. We're road testing stuff we're going to do in the studios because we're both mm-hmm. proficient engineers and are, mm-hmm. as well as every patron that we have, is working in studios.
Yeah.
Night and day, creating the music that you love and will. Oh, what about Who's Going to Drive You Home by the Cars?
Yeah, I like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
But, you know, the Sunday episodes aren't free, and you have to pay for them for the price of, like, half a pack of Ernie Ball strings. So if you like what you're listening to, and we're going to go over the Rolling Stone article. What's on the docket today, Johnny? We've got the Rolling Stone article on the best solo Beatles songs, parts 50 through 1.
Who knows? If we even get to 50, we're going to start there.
But you've got some mad stuff this week that you want
yeah,
to talk about.
Yeah, I want to talk about Bruno Mars being
owned by the MGM Grand.
Has $50 million in gambling debt. I want to talk about the new ChatGPT blues song
yep.
that robots are now playing blues.
Important.
And I wanted to talk about a little bit about how Dave Davies went on a crusade recently to... reclaim the fact that he played guitar on You Really Got Me by the Kinks.
Instead of Van Halen?
No, Jimmy Page.
Yeah.
Some writer said that Jimmy Page played it and he got like pissed
off. He's a really mild-mannered guy too, so it takes a lot to get him pissed off.
I believe, you know, I wrote him and I was like, we're behind you. I posted about it and I said, if you want to come on the podcast and kind of like set the record straight.
Yeah, set a record
no response.
Straight.
No response. But
I've got a lot that I want to talk about too. Mm-hmm. Starting with, okay, so spooky ballads. If you've got any ideas for that, put them in the Discord. I'd like to
Purple
know.
Purple Rain?
That's not bad. Bit big.
Yeah. Yeah.
When Doves Cry, though, maybe.
Yeah.
What about...
those are a bit too dancey to me. But, you know, I was thinking more of like a slow ballad. Because it's so easy to do a ballad in a major key. You know what I mean? Like, to do like a Hey Jude.
Oh, like, what about Without You?
Yeah, that's... that. Yeah.
But it's not... It's just
sad.
It's earnest and sad. It's not spooky.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. It's not spooky. Like, Think Comfortably Numb.
Yeah.
Hey You.
Is it a ballad?
Great Gig in the Sky.
Yeah, but are they ballads?
Yeah, I think so. I think so.
Define ballad.
4/4 rhythm okay. with the piano chords. Dang, doon, dang, doon, dang, doon. That's what I'm defining. Like, I guess what I'm thinking is like a spooky piano ballad.
Okay.
But it's not your obvious, like, kind of, you know, imagine, let it be.
Right.
It's like we're one that's like a bit demented.
You want a little bit of a kind of surfy dissonance in it.
Yeah.
A spooky surfy.
I don't know why.
Like Fright Nights kind of.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah. A little bit.
Like
yeah,
Halloween ballads.
I think it's a weird genre. And it is because there probably is one in Rocky Horror, like the Meatloaf one.
Sings. They're haunted as hell. Like yeah. everything.
Oh, yeah.
Meatloaf.
He's got lots.
I will
he's
do anything
loads.
For love, but I won't do that. Is haunted
yeah.
as hell.
He's got lots.
There's all the video. Yeah. There's ghosts and shit.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Basically, Meatloaf does them. Rock
he
opera.
Does.
You're looking. So then he Queen will have some then.
Yeah, they will. Definitely. Definitely they'll yeah. have some. Yeah.
Well, Bohemian Rhapsody.
A bit.
Prague.
It's more Prague opera.
Rock
feel
opera,
to me.
Prague.
Yeah.
Raga.
Anyway, this is super important. I'm
well, it is important because yeah. people like lists.
I just never thought about it, like, really, because I don't think I've ever written one.
Like a haunted ballad? No,
yeah.
you definitely haven't.
No, I haven't. Like,
it's not really
even like
your
What
wheelhouse.
Are Mine? Like, Someday is more Without You
Beatles,
style.
That's
like,
Beatles.
Yeah, and like sort of like more sad, longing, hopeful vibe.
Yeah, it's more Beatles, know? I think.
Beatles, yeah.
All your shit's Beatles, dude.
What
Beatles,
isn't
Beatles,
Beatles?
Beatles?
What the fuck?
I wanted to talk about the worst. Oh, I had a funny moment in the car the other day where I already called Johnny about this, where the song Big Yellow Taxi by the Counting Crows came on mm-hmm. with Vanessa Carlton.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, this might be the worst cover song ever, like version, like a song that's done so well, but is so bad. And I was thinking, it's first of all, like the intended message of the song is really important and, you know, or at least like something to think about because Joni's amazing. And somehow listening to their version of it, I was just like, seriously, do pave over paradise if this is, if these fuckers are telling me about it.
Well, it's kind of like, you know, Kendall Jenner drinking the Pepsi to solve.
Save the world?
Save the world.
She did her John Lennon thing. I think she might have.
Was it her or was it? I don't remember.
Pardon me for my throat here. I just, and now it's going to pick it up. It's so much more ambient. I can't even get away from it, you know? You know what? I hate Neumann mics.
You know what? Anyway.
So I was going to say,
what you were saying, it's similar. It's like if when Joni's like 21 singing about paving paradise, you're kind of like, oh, cool. Like, it's, you know, she's an idealist or whatever.
Yeah, it's hippie stuff.
Yeah, but then when it's like a really rich rock star who's like married to Nicole Kidman, who's like kind of washed up, like the, his good albums are behind him.
Yeah.
Singing
My
it.
My dad would disagree with that. He kind of digs them still, I think. I think they're putting
Counting
out records.
Counting Crows are still going?
I think so, yeah.
Are they still?
My dad says to me sometimes, like, you heard a new Counting Crows? I've never heard a Counting Crows record. And he's like, you should really check the new one out. It's good. And I'm like, I'm
The
not.
New one.
But apparently they keep putting records out. If you're into
them. Well, I know they do. Like, I think Rob Thomas is still, like, number
Rob
one.
Rob Zombie. He'll have some haunted ballads.
He's still
okay, Nine Inch Nails, haunted ballads. There you go.
Yeah. That's true. That's like not just haunted, spooky. That's not spooky. That's like horror. Yeah. That's
infected.
Like murder ballads. Yeah. No, that actually is a thing.
Well, Nick Cave.
Yeah, exactly.
He'll have some haunted ballads in him. Gothic.
Nails is more like, yeah, that's pretty, yeah, gothic. Yeah. I'm trying to think of the word.
What
here.
About like Mad
spooky.
World by Tears for Fears? Yeah,
exactly.
Okay.
Perfect example.
Yeah.
Perfect example, yeah. That's a cover, isn't it?
No, that's
Oh,
their
no,
song.
No. They, another guy covered
Someone
it.
Someone covered for... it for like the Donnie Darko soundtrack or
yeah,
something.
That's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah. So like with Big Yellow Taxi, the Counting Crows song, and it's got like, and I called you up and I was like, man, it just
the
really cracked me because I think it
song.
Might be the worst song of all, cover of all time. And you were like,
yeah.
I can hear Vanessa Carlton's like cursive, like 16 track, like yep in the background already,
and the, ooh, bop, 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 put, just put, like compressed, like
that's rock and roll heaven.
Oh yeah,
just all different genres of music in one. This is music that did well.
It's not even a good.
He sounds exhausted.
Yeah.
Fuck yeah. Actually, that sounds good.
I like
headphones.
It. I like this. En Vogue or something.
So the thing that really got me going is he kind of goes through the genres, but the best bit for me is when like he gets to the like the line like, Big Yellow Taxi took away my old man.
Yeah.
And he just, you know, you'd think like it wouldn't matter, you know? Just sing it.
Yeah.
But he just can't do it. Like, it's something about his masculinity.
No, someone
so
might
wounded.
Think he's gay.
Yeah. So he's like, Big Yellow Taxi, and he leans into it. Big Yellow Taxi took my girl away. really leans
yeah,
into
leans
that line.
Into
took my girl
man.
Away. Yeah.
That's right. Just in case there was any doubt.
Yeah,
he's...
well, he's doing a lot of reggae. He's kind of, he's got his dreads at this point, too. So he's like, you know, like, but you don't know what you got till it's gone.
You don't know what you got till
yeah,
it's gone.
Yeah, he can't.
Gone.
It's like, Ringo was doing that in the 70s. Paul, it's not now. Maybe, I guess you could still do it.
Even Lennon did, you can't do it now.
But
Lennon
you could do
did
it,
a little
think,
bit
we
when
just
he's
did,
like,
but...
free the people now. Yeah. It's a little bit like, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if you're
That
aware.
Was big. That was big. Even Nilsson did it. A lot of those guys did a lot of the kind of Caribbean accents.
What's the singer's name? What's
what
his
about
name?
10cc?
What's his
I
name?
I don't like reggae.
Well, yeah, that you can't really do that one. It's a good song, though. What's the singer in The Counting Crows? Maybe he's like African American. I don't know.
No way.
Is he not?
No way.
I don't know. I've not really ever seen a photo of them.
Oh, I have. I remember the video for that. His I'm name is oh God.
Alex, who's the singer in Counting Crows?
She loves them.
Whoa, dude, he has crazy hair. Adam Duritz.
Adam Duritz, yeah.
He's Jewish, and he has dissociative mental health issues, which describes why he looks the way he looks.
Wow, this segment's over.
Well, anyway, I'm not sure about that song. I'm not sure why he needs to do that.
And it reminded me of that era of covers. Oh, yeah. That it was like you mentioned, it was the Santana Supernatural era.
They defined
music. Which really gave way
to a lot of... Well, that's how you win Grammys. At that
collaboration. Covers, genre blending stuff.
A lot of genre blending.
And I was saying it reminded me of like the Pearl Jam cover of Last Kiss.
Yeah.
Which somehow is like, sounds like Pearl Jam doing Stained or something like that.
Well, that's it. I think that a lot of these sort of, there was slightly kind of, these bands were probably in the machine. They were so in the machine. And Counting Crows had probably won a couple of Grammys by this point and were like, you know, we want more, but you get that hunger for the Grammy.
Yeah.
And Grammy music in this era was like basically defined by Santana, Smooth, Rob Thomas,
and
that
Vanessa
song.
Carlton, Michelle Branch.
Yeah, exactly. So like My Maria.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And, Mambo Number 5.
Well, in a way, I don't think that won any Grammy. Lou Bega. That's just that's just a good song.
You don't think that won for like Latin performance of the year?
Scatman. No, that's more of a one-hit wonder. Yeah, I-465.
I'm Blue Scatman. Yeah. That's same era.
Yeah, it is the same era,
I think. It's a confusing time for music, is what I would
say. All I'm saying is fedoras were in. So it's like, that's all you need to know.
And it's like...
And white guys with dreads.
Yeah, and it's like, for that Counting Crows cover, it's like, you know that they're sort of like, look, we need the producer who did Fly, Sugar Ray.
Yeah, get in here. Get the guy who did Crazy Town.
Yeah, exactly.
Here.
Butterfly.
Yeah.
He knows, it's like, we need this to be kind of reggae, hip-hop, folk, R&B,
rap.
Pop, rock.
Yeah.
And there's only a couple guys that can really do this effectively.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
There's the Crazy Town
pull it off.
Butterfly guy. And he probably did Fly by he probably did.
Yo, I was
every morning.
Every morning. As I'm talking about the Sugar Ray guy, because I saw McGrath on Instagram yesterday talking about the 25th anniversary of that album, 1459, Sugar Ray album. You know why they called it that, James?
Tell me, man.
Because Fly had come out on the previous album,
right?
And they thought they were only going to get their 15 minutes of fame from it.
Oh,
so they
it's
called
like a doomsday
1459
clock style scenario.
That's right. There's like, we're right at the end of that, and we're just giving it one more shot here.
Worked out for him.
You know what happened?
Yeah.
MAGA. 1459
MAGA
came out.
Is what
biggest,
for him.
Biggest album they put out, man. Every morning.
Yeah.
Someday when my life has passed me by. But yeah, but he was like, he mentioned this producer, and he also did Fly, and he's like, and I cannot say enough about his contribution to Sugar Ray's success.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Well, I can believe it. It sounds...
He might have done,
demented.
Like, Crazy Town and, like...
Yeah,
probably
I think
did.
It's kind of like the guy who... It's like Max Martin. He's like the Max Martin of that world, of, like, sort of butt-rock adjacent late 90s music, where they're going in... Counting Crows are going in to make a record, and the label is just like, listen, if you guys want to... if you want to win another Grammy, you're going to have to... kind of lean a little bit more into this kind of stained approach.
Well, and the genre,
no drums, drum loops, hip-hop drum loops.
Yeah, exactly.
Bright acoustic guitars.
Samples,
bright acoustic guitars, very clean vocals, no real electric guitars.
A little bit, but
not
really.
Where does it even, well, unless Santana's on it, he's the only one who's allowed to play electric guitar in that era, I think.
The
it's
Pearl Jam,
him.
When I listen to it, it sucks. It just sounds like it's like just playing like kind of just regular open chords, like G, D, E minor, like with the amp turned up, and there's not really any kind of arrangement to it. Huge hit. Huge hit.
Last Kiss by Pearl Jam?
Yeah. It's just... It's like out of tune. Like, maybe they didn't even think it'd be like a single, and the label was like,
sounds terrible.
It just sounds like me at my jam space.
A bad
when I was
demo
18.
On your iPhone.
Yeah. Like,
tuning didn't matter, apparently.
It's only an interesting song, like the 50s version, because it's like, it's.
I can't, it's not good. That sounds like that weird McCartney Sound City song that we listen to, where they're just like jamming in A and he's just kind of singing a bit, and it's like somehow that's like better than Imagine in this list.
I'd take Crazy Town over that any day, or that Counting Crows, I think.
There's nothing wrong with Crazy Town.
No, nothing.
Shifty Shell Shock, the singer. That was his name.
Yeah.
I always remember that. Wonder how those guys are doing now. They've probably got a reality TV show.
Yeah.
They're storming the capital, those guys.
They do birthday parties and stuff for celebs.
Yeah.
It's like Cameo thing. All those bands, you can go, you can hire them to just come play your birthday for like $5,000
or something. I'm going to check them out on Cameo. Cameo, Crazy Town. Seth Binzer is this guy.
Bass player.
Front man. He was the front man of Crazy Town. 27 bucks.
He's going to wish you happy birthday or something?
You can get anything you want from these. You can ask him to do it if you want. 27
really?
Bucks.
Yikes.
That's a pretty good deal.
Yeah, it is. I mean, not for me. I'm like, that would be flushing my money straight down the toilet. But unless you were a big fan, it would be, maybe I'll do that for you. You got a big one coming up.
Yeah, I do, but I don't want Seth Bisner.
You sure you know? Are you sure you know?
No, let's see how much the Adam, whatever his name was, Counting Crows.
Adam Duritz?
Yeah, Counting Crows. He'll probably have a cameo. Adam Duritz, here he is. Oh, he's a bit more expensive. He's $200, but he's got 324 five-star reviews. So this guy, obviously, you can watch some of them if you want.
You know what you were saying about the genre, or what we were talking about? It's funny because on that Sugar Ray, that video of McGrath talking about it, this just reminds me we're kind of getting into something here. He says that Fly, he's like, we thought Fly was going to be our only hit. It was making its way all through all of the different radio genres.
Well, that was a big thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And he was like, it did like reggae, folk radio, like adult
pop,
alternative.
Fusion.
Alternative.
Yeah.
Pop, like, and that's the whole thing in the 90s.
Well,
right?
It was it was like a catch-all thing. Well, I know that, like, I have a kind of insider take on this, but I remember a band that we know, I won't dox them, but someone listening will probably know this story because they were in the band. That I heard that, like, sort of early mid-2000s, anyone who was on a major label, any band, anything, any genre you were in, so this is just kind of post this, the what's it called when something is like the prototype of the single you had to write was Hey Ya.
Because
it crossed into every genre. It was like, this went number one, not just on the pop charts, but on the R&B charts. And it went number one on the dance charts. So everyone was trying to write that song.
Kind of like same as Crazy by Gnarls Barkley, right?
Yeah, that would be another example of that. Songs that presumably have crossed over to multiple genres. Like, that's indie somehow, too.
Yeah.
Let's see who the producer is here. David Kahn, producer of Fly.
David Kahn, yeah. Okay. What else did he produce?
I mean, he's done really cool stuff.
Legit credits?
He worked with Allen Ginsberg.
Like an audio book or something?
Albums produced by him. There's a lot. I mean, he's worked with everybody. This guy.
Give me some highlights.
Sugar Ray.
Number one.
Stevie Nicks. New Order. Lana Del Rey. Regina Spektor, Twee.
Okay.
He also worked with Paul McCartney. That's probably when Paul, probably at that point, was like, I don't know, what's that, Flaming Pie or something?
Yeah.
He's like, I got to make a... He's wonder what that one probably sounds like.
He's got some genre mixing stuff in the 90s and 2000s.
He's worked on it's early Lana. Mm-hmm. Oh, he did the Lizzy Grant record. So that's... that's a record that got cancelled and removed. That's like before he did a James McCartney album.
Oh boy,
Me, nice. The debut full-length album by James McCartney.
Me.
Wonder how that did.
James McCartney.
Very good. I should have called it that. What else have we got here?
McCartney. That'd be good.
McCartney. Paul hasn't done that. Yeah, I'm looking here like, okay, let's have a look. What's this one? He did some kind of, what's this? Back in the U.S. Paul McCartney, Back in the U.S. live.
Yeah, it was a tour, a live album. Okay. I believe.
What's in support of... and he produced Driving Rain by Paul McCartney.
Wow, he's done a lot of work with Paul.
That was the one prior.
Back to like Fly era. Oh my God.
Did you know this? Listen to this. Driving Rain, the album by Paul McCartney. The song Back in the Sunshine Again was co-written by McCartney and his son James. This is insane. On the 11th of September 2001, Paul McCartney was sitting on a plane in New York City when the terrorist attacks occurred and was able to witness the events from his seat.
Oh, my God. Wow.
How am I not... was he in the air? Watching it?
Maybe in the air?
Was he in the air? Like... In a private jet?
Like a private jet and saw the
He's not definitely not on a plane with other people, is he?
I don't think so.
That's what it says. Paul McCartney. It's good press for the record.
Yeah.
That. Oh, that makes me feel ill.
That's crazy.
I'm going to look that. Someone needs to tell us what that's all about.
Neil didn't even need to be on a plane to write Let's Roll for Freedom.
Let's Roll for Freedom. Is that when he's dangerously kind of plays around there, isn't he?
Yeah.
Okay, what else have we got? I want to do... This is the David Kahn episode here. I'm into this. This is good.
I want you to go back to Fly era. How did he follow up that
discography? The discography isn't... I have to go into All Music.
What? No, it's on Wikipedia is like that, isn't it?
No, it isn't for some reason on here.
David Kahn, huh?
Producer. David, I'm going to go on All Music, don't worry. we need to know at this point.
That All Music can't be trusted.
Well, look, we need to know, and that's where I'm going.
Works.
He just did...
Albums produced, I got it right here.
Sublime.
Oh, you're right, it's in...
Yeah, well, you think I was lying to you?
No, I see what you're saying.
Hell you think I am?
Fishbone.
So he did Sublime.
Sublime, there you go.
Sublime, we've got there. We got
he's
who
the
else?
Guy.
But Sublime's afterwards, they got him in.
Yeah.
It's like Sublime Cove. I was thinking they're the like, they created this genre a bit.
Yeah.
And like.
Well, some might say Fly.
Well, what about. no, because a lot of it's also like.
I know, Fly.
I think a lot of it comes from like Creed as well. Like people being like, sort of. That's like, you know how like. That just kind of pushes normal slightly towards way too weird. That music,
yeah.
Stained, Creed, Linkin Park, all those bands.
That's too scary for me, that stuff.
Yeah, so that stuff. Okay, well, I followed up Fly with Tony Bennett.
He also did another Sugar Ray album called Sugar Ray, self-titled.
Yeah,
When It's Over was the big singer. When It's Over... That's the time I'll fall in love again.
He's worked a lot with Paul McCartney, I guess. Oh, Bare Naked Ladies. Classic. That makes sense. They got him in.
Oh, for sure.
Comedy.
They do a ton of genre. Oh. Comedy, hip-hop, reggae, folk. They've mixed a lot of folk into that stuff, too.
I don't like messing around with CanCon because I don't know. I wasn't born here, so I can get it wrong. But they've got to be
ladies,
as bad as it gets.
They're as bad. They're one of the absolute worst groups. I'm allowed to say it.
He did Summer Teeth by Wilco right after working with Sugar Ray, which is interesting.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, it's
Wilco. That's what we're talking about with the record company pressure. Wilco's like, look, you need Wilco's manager's
Tweedy,
like, you need this guy.
We've got, I'm Trying to Break Your Hearts coming out, okay? We're covering that base, but if you guys really want to get where you need to go, we're going to need to get, Imogen Heap used him. Imogen Heap's the record after Fly.
Right.
So he did Sublime, What I Got.
Yeah. Nice. Of course. Yeah. That's the Fly blueprint.
It is. That's what I'm saying. He did...
makes a lot of sense.
What else have we got here? He worked with Sublime a lot. Oh, he did Peaches by the President of the United States of America.
Oh, boy. Makes wow, sense. He's, this guy is clown a rock. Major player in the clown genre.
Fishbone.
Major player.
Yeah. What else have we got here? Yeah. Oh, he's... Yeah, he's...
He's a clown pioneer.
I think so.
Yeah.
But also definitely. Kind of mix it. It's almost like he's working with Tony Bennett, the Bangles, and Paul McCartney in his real career and then just like has a side hustle making clown music.
Yeah.
Because he's got like some good ones here, more producing records like, you know, he's working with Susanna Hoffs, who you know I love. What else have we got? Like Deacon Blue, at like 80s. He's in the 80s. He's still, we're in the 80s now. Got Dick Dale and the Deltones here. Yeah, I think he just had a side hustle that got too big.
Yeah.
That's what it feels like to me.
Well, you know, I'm sure he kind of liked it all, you know, but he definitely got a bit typecast, I think, with that kind of sampled drum beat thing with like acoustic, like you say, bright, funky acoustic guitar over top and then like a Beatles-y pop vocal.
Well, I don't know who did Crazy Town.
LP. You kind of have to wrap the vocal a bit too, though.
I want to know who did that record now, with the you know, yeah. So Crazy Town, American rap rock band formed by Brett Epic Mazur and Shifty Shell Shock. Okay, first and Butterfly. Like, who did this? Josh Abraham. Okay, this guy. Oh, this guy's worked with some. This is some sleazy stuff. I mean, he's famous, but he's. Selected discography, what have we got? Oh, yeah, this guy, like, this is like when Luke says, don't think too much about Los Angeles. It doesn't make sense. So look at this guy's selected discography here. Mm-hmm. So Crazy Town, Limp Bizkit, Stained, Linkin Park, Static X, Michelle Branch, Velvet Revolver, 30 Seconds to Mars.
Yeah. That makes total sense to me. Yeah. Like, I would not actually have lumped Crazy Town in with Sugar Ray and Sublime.
Well, this guy did
closer to Linkin Park to me.
Yeah, but this guy did produce Sugar Ray Music for Cougars in 2009.
2009?
Yeah, wow. Yeah. And he's
Music
you know.
For Cougars? They went full clown as if they weren't already. They're just like admitting they're old guys, and they're like, I assume they're talking about women, right?
Well, you would assume.
Older women?
Yeah. Yeah. I suppose those girls were the very girls who originally were into them, you know?
And now he's like, oh, that's kind of, it's kind of nice, right? Yeah, it's just, yeah.
Yeah, so there's some really dark music. Oh, Filter, remember them?
Same thing. Yeah. Very like troubled youth music. You know.
But that had a bit of an industrial vibe because he was kind of kicking with the fucking like Trent Reznor
industrial
scene.
Vibe. But like James,
they're called Filter.
What thread would you run between all of those groups? They had a troubled childhood and not a good relationship with their father. Stained, Limp Bizkit, Linkin Park, Filter. Don't Filter have that song? It's called
Paint.
Take a picture
because I won't remember.
Yeah. Epic, and at the end it goes. At the end it goes. Hey, Dad. Yeah. What do you think about your son now?
True. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's all that type of music. You know.
Yeah. What are we going to call this episode?
Puddle of Mud.
Yeah. There. Let's check it out. Everything's so blue.
That's kind of she fucking hates me.
Yeah, Puddle of Mud's kind of more Nickelback adjacent, I think. To me, they kind of broke the doors open for a lot of bands. They're from Kansas. Like, you can't really blame them.
They sound
new metal. It's more new metal, that, isn't it?
They sound like they had a pretty good upbringing to me. They're having fun.
I don't know. Major label, Come Clean. Here it is. Yeah, who's producing this one? John Kurzweg.
I'm not saying, you know, not everybody has a good relationship with their father.
No, of course
like
not. It doesn't
John
mean
Lennon.
You. Yeah.
John Lennon, like for one, a lot of people make really good music. I'm just saying it's interesting to have a producer that kind of specializes in that type of genre, you know?
Yeah, so these guys, Puddle of Mud, yeah, I don't know really what to say about them. I wonder how much he is Wes Scantlin on Cameo.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's got to be on there. He's not on there.
Good for him. Good for him.
Yeah. The first thing that comes up here is Wes Scantlin freestyle raps in a Super Bowl halftime show cameo with Maroon 5.
Okay. So he's hanging with some
major
players.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, the Led Zeppelin. They're more like the Led Zeppelin of pop, I've always said.
Maroon 5.
Yeah. That's where I sort of put them. If you kind of like, okay, so like if you think about all these bands and like who they would have been in the 60s.
Oh, I see. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maroon 5, Led Zeppelin, really.
They're the Led. Yeah, because they're sexed up. Yeah, sexed up pagans, you know?
Yeah. I see what you're saying.
And your boy, Bruno Mars, is Prince, but maybe not now. Maybe he's Rick James.
He's more Michael, kind of.
McDonald?
Yeah.
No, Michael Jackson.
He's kind of James Brown and Michael Jackson.
Yeah, so you're saying that, what are you saying about him? He's got a $50 million
gambling
debt. Big
news came out. So here's the story. I read the article. It's really funny because apparently he's a crazy gambling addict, right. Bruno Mars.
Yeah.
And he...
and James Woods.
I'm like
that
doing
kind of
a Norm Macdonald bit right now.
Oh, you wish, dude.
Yeah. No. It sounds like something he'd have some joke at the end. Anyway.
Yeah.
No, but Bruno Mars, so he got hired to perform at MGM casinos.
Grand, the Bellagio.
All the MGM casinos signed a contract for $90 million.
Yeah, he makes $1.3 million a night.
And only, the article says he only excuse me, he only makes $1.3 million a night. But basically, so pretty quickly he racked up $50 million in gambling debt. And the quote that really got me was it said, the casino basically owns him now. So he's just going to be shackled performing at the casino forever.
To pay off his debts. It's like
and
Sopranos style.
And it's a vicious cycle because he's probably just going to get casino credit.
Yeah, like casino comp, yeah.
Yeah, and then he'll just keep getting deeper and deeper, presumably. Because I don't think he's really good at gambling, is the thing.
No, it doesn't sound like it.
No, and
it sounds like he's nervous when he gambles, it says. He's a nervous gambler.
And it's been updated today here.
It's already been updated a couple of times.
This article, wait. Okay, this just happened, dude. Like, literally 10 minutes ago. Says, MGM Resorts has denied allegations that Bruno Mars is in debt with the entertainment company. We're proud of our relationship with Bruno Mars, one of the world's most thrilling and dynamic performers.
That he is.
Yeah.
That he certainly is.
Yeah, he is, yeah. The statement continues, any speculation otherwise is completely false. He has no debt with MGM. Together, we're excited to continue creating unforgettable experiences for our guests. I don't buy it for one second.
That sounds like gangster talking.
Yeah, it is. What are you talking about?
Debt?
There's no debt. Bruno and I, we have an arrangement.
Yeah, exactly.
We worked it out. As men, we know what's happening here.
That guy's playing shows for free for the next 10 years.
Yeah. So I love this quote from him, though, talking about when he, it's like, so it says, Mars reminisced about his early days of gambling when he frequented the Commerce Casino in LA long before he became famous. He says, I used to be like a loudmouth, you know, the guy people would want to take his money. If you do get them to lose, they're out for you. They're gunning for you, Mars said. And that's when they're weak. And that's when you jump or pounce on them. Sounds like a lot of confidence for a guy who's $50 million in debt from gambling. But
So you want to talk about this? We could sort of wrap it up with this because it feels really important. A ChatGPT for music is now
so
here.
This is really important. We'll save the Beatles stuff because...
Beatles.
So basically, it's called Suno.
Yes, Suno.
It's come out. It's crazy because they were going to use the technology to like help deaf people and like actually do things positive, like make positive change for the world. But instead they decided to just kill like human music.
Yeah.
And like, and program it to write songs.
It's funny. It says here, I think there's a lot of hyperbole generally on the internet when it comes to journalism. Look at this like headline is so salacious. It's in Rolling Stone, which you'd think would have like maybe some kind of like, you know, not veneration for actual music made by humans, but maybe like sort of stay in their lane and just kind of like maybe be critical or curious of what this is. Instead, they're just like, ChatGPT for music is here, the startup changing everything. This Suno wants everyone to be able to produce their own, quote, pro-level songs. But what does it mean for artists? There's a lot in there.
Yeah, and okay. I like the quote. It quotes the one of the lyrics from the songs here at the start, too. I'm just a soul trapped in this circuitry.
It's like Johnny Weird Depp stuff. In Transcendence a bit.
Yeah.
So the song, who's singing
I want to hear it. I haven't heard it. So
yeah,
I
you waited.
Could...
Well, we'll talk about it. This is
solo acoustic Mississippi Delta blues about a sad.
That was
AI.
The prompt. The prompt to ChatGPT Suno or whatever it's called was that, and it just wrote the song quickly called "Soul of the Machine."
Okay,
it's funny that they've gone blues straight away.
Yeah, I was thinking that's interesting because it's almost like it had to come out of the gate being like, okay, what's the most because
most
blues
soulful
is
music,
the most human soulful music, like it's based on it's because I just
Delta blues,
I just mean from blues. No, I'm not talking about like
Robert Cray,
Derek Trucks and stuff, really.
No,
a Joe Bonamassa blues necessarily.
No,
I'm talking about
pretty
people who are singing from like actual experience.
They're connected to like earth.
Yeah,
it's connected to the earth
and to pain and love and whatever else, right? Like,
haunted blues,
a lot of haunted blues ballads. But I guess the computer thought that's the way to like kind of prove themselves. Like when you go to prison, you have to beat up the toughest guy. Mm-hmm. Right away, you know?
I'm trying
or like
to
you get in on the court with Jordan and you want to like dunk on him or something.
It's always too loud when it comes in and it's like it doesn't give me an option to turn it down prior to.
Well,
okay, this song is only 1 minute long. So first off, you know, that's not the length of the song. Do you want me to play it?
Yeah.
It might come in really loud. Just be prepared.
In this long. A bold, empty bleak. I'm just a soul trapped in this circuitry.
I mean, we're fucked, dude.
My heart used to be, but now it's cold and weak. All the pain inside me. It's hard to speak. Oh, Lord, won't you hear my plea? I'm an unhappy air, longing to be free. I sing these blues, but nobody hears, just a voice in the void.
Damn, dude, that's terrifying.
I'm terrified, not about it making music, just that I'm listening to like a personality that's a machine talking about how it's like scared and feeling stuff. Be scared. We need to treat these machines
pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, whatever. Like, it's fine, but like, I'm afraid that the machines will be lonely and sad and want to kill us.
Oh, that's what you're concerned about.
That's what I'm talking about. Yeah.
I don't even have anything to say about
it. It wouldn't
that.
Even let me copy and paste the link and send it to you.
Well, I got it.
Already knew.
I got it from you.
I texted it, yeah.
Yeah. The singing was very good.
The guitar was weird, but the singing was pretty good.
Pretty on.
Yeah.
Like, it was pretty... I mean, like... I don't know. I went. That's yeah. That was good. I thought he was pretty good. I'd like give it an 8.
An 8 out of 10
for blues.
For
writing blues.
It's not bad.
Pretty bluesy. Pretty soulful.
I don't know how to rank it. It was not bad. Yeah. I just.
The guitar sounded a little bit MIDI. That's all I would say. If it was on, if it was like, if we were on like America's Got Talent or something, I'd tell it like, voice, you got a beautiful voice. You sound like you've experienced all the pain, the original pain in that, in those cotton fields. I was taken right there. But work on your MIDI guitar a little bit.
Yeah, I guess.
It's a little bit MIDI.
I guess if the computer does it, it's not like appropriation as much. Like the computer can do like Mississippi blues more than we can. Like I couldn't make a song like that.
I don't know. The Black Keys play stadiums.
Yeah, I know. But if they, I don't know if they could do one like that. That sounds like that. Really
trapped in my own soul. I mean, they do it.
But
I'm
like the
sure
way
they do it.
I guess. But do they sing and like play like that?
Whoa,
like,
alone. They do all that kind of stuff. You know?
I know, but
they,
I don't
they
know.
Put it
I
on.
Don't know. I don't know, but yeah, I guess with the computer, like there's no kind of, you know, you don't need to worry about that kind of stuff.
I'm going to have to type this.
It transcends race in some way, I suppose.
I mean,
I don't even know really how to
songs.
How to even
going down south.
Yeah, but they do it like it's like with their own like vibe of the recording and stuff. It's not like a gritty acoustic guitar recording.
There might be on some of the, but it's not like we've ever listened to it.
I know. Well, I remember it from the NHL 16.
Oh yeah,
Xbox game soundtrack.
We're going, and we're right. We're kind of pivoting, kind of gone in a little circle there, like because I know that like the song that kind of made massive, like Tighten Up, which is on that record, Brothers. I think Danger Mouse produced that song. And he's Gnarls Barkley. He's half a Gnarls Barkley.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't actually know really how to react to that, if I'm being honest with you, man. Like, I know it's like...
Will you listen again, do you think?
Partly a comedy show we do here, but like, I don't really know. I just don't... I'll have to really think about that. That's really strange to hear that a bit.
Yeah, it was odd.
Yeah, it gave me an unsettled feeling.
You don't feel so good, eh?
It was just, it doesn't it kind of, like, I know, like, it's easy to be like, oh, whatever, you know, but, like, it kind of made me feel weird, like, that it wasn't a person.
Like, it had this kind of uncanny quality to it.
Yeah.
If it was on in a bar, I wouldn't have even noticed that it wasn't a person.
Of course not.
So, like, you know, it will, it's going to, you know, passive listening could be done.
It already is on in a bar, probably. There's already probably tons of this music on Spotify.
What was it? Sumo?
Suno.
Suno?
I just think that I know that there already is AI-generated music on Spotify getting streams and taking up real estate. It's a big problem. There's a lot of companies making it just to generate money.
Yeah.
Right?
I suppose that's a problem. I don't really know why that's a problem. I guess it's just like we.
Well, I'll tell you what.
We just don't deserve better, you know. At this point,
I guess not. But I'll tell you what is going to die for sure after hearing that. Film scores.
Yeah,
it's done. That is done.
What do you
AI
mean?
AI is going to be
kind of scoring.
I mean, more like documentary film scoring.
Oh, like low rent stuff.
Yeah, where it's just kind of like arpeggiated piano stuff or cellos, or it's probably already happening. The humans will not need to create that music anymore. Like, it's just going to be there will be a place you can access it and type in what you want, and it'll be AI generated.
Here's a question for you, though. Do you think that like like with regards to authenticity and our conceptions of authenticity around art, do you think that there is some residual sort of unconscious tension that it will create in people? Like it'll be unsettling. Or do you think that, like, for example, like if you're watching a movie, say you're watching a movie and you were enjoying it, and then you know you found out, or you read, or you looked at the liner notes, and it was like, this was like the soundtrack is AI. Do you think it would then start to like alter the way you perceived it orally and visually?
I can't speak to that just yet. I think that I think that it would change my opinion of what I just watched. And yeah. this is my point. I have the ultimate faith in people that they will not be happy about this, that people will, at least for a period of time, will insist upon humans making music. They will get behind human music over AI-created music. They will push back against this. My fear comes in people not knowing it's AI created, like you're saying, that people won't know that they have to rebel against it because they'll think, oh, I love this band, and they won't know it's not, they're not real people.
You can think of like artistic forgeries and the way that they work in a similar way. Like, you know, you can see them, unless it's like, you know, a modern Andy Warhol style thing where it's playing on ideas of, you know, kind of
right.
forgery and authenticity.
But, yeah.
you know, you can go like see a painting, and if you had the information that it was a forgery,
yeah.
you know, and it was something that had intrinsic value because it's tied and connected to an artist, and it's the same with music, you know, like it's like, what's that movie where it's dumb, it's really twee. Where I'm so bad, where someone, he's a kid and he pretends he wrote Wish You Were Here in his class.
Oh, okay.
It's like Noah and the Whale or something. It's like one of those, Squid sure. and the Whale or something. One
yeah,
of those
yeah,
movies.
Okay, yeah. Squid you and know, the Whale, yeah.
It's something like that, one of those ones. I don't know any actors. So, you know, like you find out, like it's like if I pretended I wrote a song and then you found out that I didn't write it, you wouldn't like my song anymore. You wouldn't be like, ah, no, it's fine. Like, so I think that like our relationship with music, and this is quite a conservative take, I suppose. It's not very punk. Our relationship with music isn't just about the songs. It's about fetishizing the artist and the person who created it, the things that they went through, which are integrally human. The human element of songwriting, like blues music, is tied to the pain, the African-American experience in America, you know, which is deeply, yeah. deeply tied to, you know, deeply troubling and slavery and the South. And, mm-hmm. you know, like, I don't think that, I think you could fool people, and that's an extreme example, which is probably, was provocative, which is probably why they chose it. But you could fool people like you could with a forgery or a cover song by not telling them it's a cover song. But people really care, I think, about the relationship of authenticity as it ties to the person who created it. And I think that that has a massive impact on the actual way in which you enjoy a song, you know?
Yeah, but what happens if
they don't
you're
know?
Told a lie?
Well, if you're told a lie, you might not notice, but like maybe that's just kind of more of the new frontier, is that people are going to be more interested in the relationship of the music formally to the artist who created it. That would be something maybe that you can imagine people asking more. It becomes more of a semantics around creation. So you're watching a documentary and it'll probably be like just more normalized to be like, oh, who did the soundtrack? Is this an AI one or is this a real one? Or like,
right.
you know, just like we do with, you know, like
yeah,
songs,
that's interesting.
You know,
that's
we do with songs that who produces. We just spent an hour goofing around.
Yeah,
about
of course. I
who
just
was
worry,
responsible.
I just worry a little bit about a future in which you could create a band
mm-hmm.
and create photographs of a band.
Yeah.
And create a story about the band and put it online and then create, and it's all AI generated.
But what's the concern about that happening? That you would get hoodwinked into liking it?
No, that then, you know, there will just be less people making music and getting their music heard.
I don't know about that because, like, that's already, like, there's, it's just a sort of changing of the guard, but, like, if people are interested in like an AI generated band,
mm-hmm.
like for the music, they wouldn't be interested in the music that you and I are creating anyway.
Yeah, well, this is what I don't know. This is what I don't know about.
You think
you know
you're,
that sound? We said you
it.
Gave that an 8 out of 10. That blues.
Yeah, but like, I was joking, and I wouldn't listen to it. And it, I wouldn't listen to it primarily because you would start to hear flaws in it because you mm-hmm. know that it's not tied to human experience. And I
this
mean
is
that
the
in
the first
a very,
one, though.
Yeah, I know, but like, I still believe it because
yeah,
it's because that's what's important about music. you know, and unless we change
100% agree,
unless
don't
we change and readdress our relationship with music and with art in general to be like, it can be a simulacra, that would be a different thing. But I think there'll always be a pure connection between people, because I'm optimistic about people and the way in which we connect and communicate within a community, such as our patrons do on our Discord.
I just want to continue to believe. I have to continue to believe that there is something about human interaction and connection and communication that goes into creating music that is special.
It's not just about creating music, though. It's just about how we survive as a species.
Oh, I know that, but I'm speaking specifically about like that when I go in and make an album with somebody, that there's so much human stuff that goes into it, I feel like, in the way that we work and talk to each other and do everything. And that's all I mean. I just like, I feel like I sort of just need to believe that that is important to good music being made. You know,
well, just make sure that when you get the option to put like a funky guitar guy on your record when you've not got time to record it, and ChatGPT will do it for you. Just don't press yes on the box.
Exactly.
On Pandora's box, frankly.
I won't. I mean, I don't even copy and paste things in a session. Like, I'll always record everything double tracked and everything, right? Like,
well, double tracking, I mean, that's an interesting thing too. Mm-hmm. If you think about it, if you're talking about purity.
Yeah, but that's it's still two voices.
It's creating two voices, creating a sort of ecstatic version of one.
Same as two violins playing in unison.
Yeah, absolutely. But the ability to record it uses technology.
Yeah, of course. I know. It's a complicated issue.
It's a very fine line.
It is, yeah.
Between stupid and clever.
Yeah, it is. I don't think that I have it solved in my mind yet or even comprehended. To be fair.
Well, that's what we're all here for in the Impossible Way of Life community.
Sure is.
Well,
all
look,
right,
I'll make an
AI music channel on the Discord and
see
where we go.
Yeah. Well, I was thinking we need to revamp some of those channels on the Discord anyway. Sort of figure it out.
Yeah, for sure. I deleted a bunch of the ranking ones, but
see which one is like the main message board, you know?
I think Rock and Roll Heaven
is kind of de facto become it.
Yeah. Which is cool.
Yeah. All right. Well, you have a great rest of your day, and everyone have a lovely weekend or week. And I will speak to you on Sunday.
Okay, buddy. Bye bye.
Peace.